Well, good evening, everyone. I'm David Wallace. I'm Deputy President of the Royal Society of Edinburgh. Absolutely delighted to welcome you all to this special occasion to mark the award of the IEEE RSE James Clerk Maxwell Medal to Professor Lynn Conway. I should say, first of all, I guess, congratulations on getting here. Well done on not succumbing to the threat of storm, Abigail, and my sincere wishes for good luck in getting home safely as well. I've got to say first some housekeeping. There's no fire alarm scheduled, so if any alarm goes off, it's for real and we have to leave the building. There are two emergency exits. This will take you out the back, this will take you out the front. The meeting point for all of us is directly across the road from the front of the Royal Society of Edinburgh, in front of the printing press. You will see its name in lights. Could you also please turn your phones to silent? And that's not least because this lecture and the award ceremony is being recorded and webcast live. So please to silent unless you wish to be an unwelcome part of posterity. An edited version of the recording will appear on the RSE website in about 2 weeks' time. A few words about the Royal Society of Edinburgh. It's Scotland's National Academy, founded in 1783. It is the embodiment of the Enlightenment in Scotland. Amongst the national academies of the world, we have a fellowship of extraordinary breadth, spanning the academic, business, and professional leadership of this country, and indeed more widely. The event this evening is one of the ways in which we fulfill the purpose, our purpose, to advance learning and useful knowledge. The James Clerk Maxwell Medal is a joint award of the RSE with the Institute of Electrical and Electronic Engineers. Now, the IEEE is the leading professional body in the world in its field, with more than 400,000 members in more than 160 countries. And the James Clerk Maxwell Medal is one of the highest awards made by IEEE. This is a very important occasion. The medal itself was established in 2006. It's named in honour of the 19th century Scottish mathematician and physicist James Clerk Maxwell. Maxwell laid the foundations of electromagnetic wave theory, radio propagation, microwave techniques, radio communications, and in fact was a model for the kind of unified theory in theoretical physics which people are still striving for. He is recognized as one of the scientific giants of the 19th century. He was elected, several of his papers were presented to the society before he was too old to present them on his own behalf, and he was elected to the fellowship of the RSE in 1856. I'm a little bit unclear, he was born in 1831, but I think he was probably aged 24 at the time. The medal has been sponsored by Wolfson Microelectronics, Edinburgh Company, since 2007, in fact between 2007 and 2014, and is now sponsored by Cirrus Logic. And I'm delighted that we have people here from Cirrus Logic and from Wolfson Microelectronics. Extremely, extremely grateful to you for supporting this event. I'm personally very delighted, we're honoured indeed, that the President-elect of the IEEE, Professor Barry Shoup, is able to be with us this evening, and I ask him now to read the citation for Professor Lynn Conway. Professor Barry Shoup.
Well, let me begin by extending my most sincere gratitude to the Royal Society President, Professor Dame Jocelyn Bell Burnell, to the fellowship and staff of the Royal Society of Edinburgh, and the Royal Society Chief Executive, Dr. William Duncan, for their warm hospitality and commitment to making this year's Maxwell Award presentation yet another resounding success. This year marks the 150th anniversary of the publication of James Clerk Maxwell's seminal paper, A Dynamical Theory of the Electromagnetic Field. It's a paper that has shaped the global scientific and engineering communities for the past 150 years and continues to shape it even today. That is why the IEEE RSE James Clerk Maxwell Award is thus named. James Clerk Maxwell was a giant of our profession, upon whose shoulders numerous generations have stood and seen further, advancing technology to benefit our world. This award recognizes the giants of our modern era, those extraordinary men and women who have created legacies of accomplishment that will serve to inspire other generations to come. Today, on behalf of more than 426,000 members and fellows of the IEEE worldwide, it is my great honor and to present 2015 Maxwell Medalist and IEEE Fellow, Professor Lynn Conway. So let me just spend a little bit of time on the citation. We recognize Lynn Conway for contributions to VLSI system design. VLSI, or very large scale integration, is the process of creating integrated circuit by combining thousands of transistors into a single chip. Though we honor and recognize Lynn Conway today for her groundbreaking work in VLSI system design, it is not the sole reason to number her among the giants of our profession. Professor Conway is also the creator of the first dynamic instruction scheduler, a breakthrough she accomplished while working on the Advanced Computing Systems project at IBM in the 1960s. The dynamic instruction scheduler has proved to be a seminal invention in computer architecture. And in today's high-performance computing systems, some 50 years later, dynamic instruction scheduling is considered a standard technique. The development of VLSI computing systems stems directly from Lynn Conway's singular and pioneering work in VLSI system design. Of especial significance is her work in the creation and fabrication of multi-project chips, which combine multiple circuit designs onto a single chip. These multi-project chips were groundbreaking innovations, dramatically reducing costs and radically simplifying the process of preparing and submitting chips for design and fabrication. However, Professor Conway's work did much more than make chip design simpler and less expensive. Her discoveries made it possible for academic researchers, students, and startup companies to prototype chips with the same level of design, validation, and verification that had been, until her breakthroughs, the sole domain of commercial efforts. Changing the way in which chip design occurred was not enough for Lynn Conway. With Dr. Carver Mead, she authored Introduction to VLSI Systems, a foundational work that taught design methods that would enable young engineers to take advantage of this newfound freedom to design and fabricate chips. As part of this incredible work, Professor Conway also introduced the concept of lambda scaling, outlining the design rules that would become the cornerstone of a diverse array of CAD tools and design methodologies. Throughout a long and distinguished career of insight, endeavor, and accomplishment, Lynn Conway has fostered a revolution, not only within her profession, but in countless professions that have been able to flourish because of her innovations and discoveries. I believe that one of her endorsers for the Maxwell Award said it best. I quote, "Her influence on modern electrical engineering is deep and profound, arguably on the scale of Armstrong and Steinmetz." Armstrong, Steinmetz, James Clerk Maxwell, all three are considered giants of our profession, and all three have made contributions to multiple disciplines in ways which continue to echo across space and time. Similarly, Lynn Conway's work has provided the underpinnings for innovations, discoveries, and achievements in every area of scientific and humanitarian study. On behalf of the IEEE, it is my great pleasure to honor a true giant of our age, Professor Lynn Conway, with the 2015 IEEE RSE James Clerk Maxwell Award.
Thank you so much.
Now I invite Lynn. Oh, more photographs. Barry, I think we should be in as well, please.
Yeah.
Shaking hands. Shaking hands.
Here we go.
Good.
Thank you. I want to thank the IEEE and the Royal Society of Edinburgh ever so much for honoring me here tonight. This means more to me than you can possibly imagine, especially an award named after James Clerk Maxwell, the great intellectual explorer whose theory of electromagnetic radiation first brought together electricity, magnetism, and light as manifestations of the same phenomenon. You know, we can learn so much by reflecting on such work and struggling to figure out, how did they do that? For example, I've long been awed by the work of Charles Proteus Steinmetz. And while meta-engineering the VLSI revolution, I followed the script that Steinmetz had used 7 decades earlier to meta-engineer the AC electricity revolution, such as the power of role models. As an early president and forerunner to the IEEE, Steinmetz also institutionalized the form of international professional society that binds so many of us together today in the generation and sharing of useful knowledge. And you know, as humanity peers ahead into uncertainty and uncertain times, we're very lucky to be among those who can envision very beautiful sunrises beyond looming or darker horizons. So, again, I want to thank you all, really, from the bottom of my heart. And now, we'll talk about some things that I've been thinking about for a number of years now. And it's just a great pleasure to share some of these ideas with you. I think you can think of this as a kind of a fun flipping through the pages of a graphic novel in process, something in the works. And as we go through the talk, just kind of watch as the pages go by to catch on to the arc of the story. And if you notice things that are intriguing as we go along, you can always return and explore them later using the many links that are actually embedded in the slideshow, which will be posted online. So here we go. To set the stage, I want to visualize some past waves that have rolled forward toward us, dropping in just before them and then coming forward through time. Okay? So we're going to do a little time travel here. We're not going to look at the history of something. We're going to go back and come forward through some things. And as we travel through time, keep these words in mind, because these are really very important. The farther backward you can look and do this sort of time traveling forward, the farther forward you can see and envision waves going forward. So let's begin in the 1400s, during the Renaissance. I think one iconic mechanism that really fascinates me is the Prague astronomical clock of 1410. The mechanization of astronomical calculations in the Renaissance, and just a stunning confluence of math, science, engineering, art, and architecture of that day, a day that actually was incredibly advanced. By the late 1400s, the advances in shipbuilding, Portuguese Carrack, navigation, the Mariner's Astrolabe, the gimbal compass, and map making reached a tipping point, triggering the age of discovery by enabling exploration across the open seas, not just along coastlines. So you had this very advanced time, and all of a sudden, a confluence of a few cluster of ideas let people take off in the open seas. And so it began, age of discovery. And think a little bit about the time scales that we're talking about, how long it took to get somewhere, to see something, to bring back news of what you'd found. Now, as mass communication by printing spread in the late 1400s, it enabled adventurers to ever more quickly propagate news of what they'd found and where they'd found it. And that dramatically enhanced the exploration rate. And so look where we are by the early 1700s. And as you think back through history, you can just think what an amazing time that was. Think of all the things in motion. But what's happening here? Is this just the exponentiation of things? Is that all it is? Or is it an exponentiation in the key clusters of innovative ideas in the minds of ever more people? Ideas on how to make and use things. Again, is this things or ideas that have really gone in motion? Especially the impact of that on this, clusters of ideas. So by the mid-1700s, of course, now the stage was set for yet another tremendous disruptive wave of innovation, the Industrial Revolution. And one thing we could focus in on that's quite interesting about the Industrial Revolution is the mining and processing of coal and iron ore was greatly amplified by steam power. So you have all these things, but you have the idea of the steam engine and the propagation of that idea. And of course, some of the resulting iron was used to make more steam engines. So there's something else that starts to play into this, that there's a positive feedback which is fueling an iterative expansion process, not only of things, but of the ideas on how to make and use the things. By the 1830s, steam-powered railroads began interconnecting mines to ironworks and railmakers. So now you have a process that can generate rails, which is starting to spread things further. Another kind of thing is spreading, including the ideas on how to make and use them. And what's sort of interesting as you look back on the history of that would be to take snapshots in time of where things were, for example, in 1830, 40, and 50, in the United States. And you can see the beginning of something. Something is really starting to happen here. Ah, but that expansion was accelerated by the rapid spread of telegraphy beginning around the 1850s, very rapid spread, connected with the spread of the railroads. And it had an effect analogous to that of printing during the Age of Discovery, but of course now everything is at a different time scale. And what we'll see if we look at a map a decade later in 1860, now look what's happening by 1870. Think what's going on here. Think of the scale of the ideas in motion in the heads of people. It's numbers that count here. 1890, take a look at that. Now, the point here is that, like compound interest, the early social diffusion rate of such clusters of technological ideas is approximately proportional to what's accumulated in the minds of the people to there at any given point in time. Well, what is that? It's an exponential function. Now, as the opportunity space fills, the diffusion rate of technological ideas slows as that particular cluster nears or begins to near its expansion limits. So we have this sort of early exploration and then later saturation, familiar process. That's a logistics function. And the logistics function has a very simple representation, and it's an exponential this way and then an exponential the other way. Now, as a result of the widespread harnessing of electricity by the 1890s, there's a whole other story of things going on. Suddenly, innovative technology clusters lurched out into wild new directions. Electric generators, motors, lights, telephones, so forth. We have this rapidly expanding, electrically empowered, huge infrastructure. And names, Edison, Westinghouse, Tesla, Steinmetz, Bell, Marconi, they were becoming famous for their roles in that. And so now we have the rapid diffusion of electrification, which we could follow the maps of that, co-evolving with the spread of lighting and interurban light rail and so forth. And so we have all these things. But now let's look at the results of that ongoing exponentiation brought up to date. Voila. I mean, you can see the amplified exponentiation of that up to now. The whole place is lit up. Just think how many minds the ideas of Faraday, Maxwell, Hertz, Steinmetz et al. Passed through to make this happen. It's very interesting to think about that propagation of ideas. Okay. Now I'd like to look at an innovation wave that I actually participated in back in the 70s. This was really fun. I surfed on this thing in the 70s. And this was the revolution in VLSI microelectronic design. Now, but while we do this, let's a little more consciously note how the flow of ideas expands as a function of the increasing connectivity, bandwidth, and decreasing time delays in social communications. And also think along lines that began to be explored by Everett Rogers in his seminal book about the diffusion of innovations, a book that actually got me thinking a lot about this decades and decades ago. The stage was set by innovations in integrated circuitry in the 1960s, enabling transistors and their wiring to basically be lithographically printed onto chips of silicon. It was further set by innovations in computing at Xerox PARC in the early 70s, including the Alto personal computer, the Ethernet, and the laser printer. These were all invented in kind of a coherent rush at Xerox Palo Alto Research Center. And by the rapid evolution of the ARPANET, coordinated and led by folks at DARPA, the early ARPANET met. So look what's happening in 1971. Boom, you have this nucleation of what really is all the seed points of the modern network, personal computer, bitmap display, mouse-driven stuff we deal with today. Now, advances in lithography enabled the printing of ever-increasing numbers of transistors on single chips, and so by 71 also, Intel introduced its 404, the first single-chip microprocessor, 2,300 transistors. Now, Gordon Moore at Intel noted that the number of transistors printable on chips commercially reliably was doubling about every 2 years. And let's look down in that lower corner there. And that's kind of a scatter plot that's roughly of that rate. But, you know, you wonder, well, okay, where is this going? How far could this go? Well, Carver Mead at Caltech named this effect Moore's Law. Smart move by Mead, and determined there were no physical limits to increasing the density up to where that number would be about a million transistors. I'll think about that. See, back right then, when it was only like 10,000, you could see that very quickly it was going to go to a million. It appeared possible that by 1990, an entire supercomputer could be printed on a single chip. A computer like the kind that I had worked on at ACS, of that level of complexity, would be printable on a single chip. It's like, just think what this does to your mind when you realize this. It's like, oh my God, this is incredible. This is coming in a rush. So in 76, this set off a push by two small research teams, one that I led at Xerox PARC, and one that Carver Mead led at Caltech, to figure out, and we collaborated on this, figure out how to enable such things to be designed. The story of what happened over the next 4 years is actually quite a saga. For insights into that, I wrote a reminiscence in 2012 that was published by the IEEE, and I would refer you to that. It was the first time I'd actually stepped forward to tell the story. And a little side note here is, since I didn't look like an engineer, at that point, actually, Silicon Valley had no clue what it had actually been doing back in the 70s. So it's kind of like, that's another whole kind of story here. But for now, we'll just hit some of the highlights. The breakout was triggered by a cluster of abstract innovations, and included were a set of scalable VLSI chip design rules, dimensionless inequality equations, which enabled chip designs to be digitally shrunk down and reused as Moore's Law rapidly advanced. They also enabled accruing open source chip subsystem designs to be widely shared among academics and young researchers, people not necessarily designing it in a corporation at the time. And let's look at this. It's sort of like thinking about steam engines, iron ore, and coal, and then producing more steam engines. Let me just want to try something here. Given that triplet lithography is going to scale down according to Moore's law, ever more, ever faster transistors can be printed on individual chips as time passed. So here's step one in a kind of way of looking at this. You take and you use your computer to design the chipset for a more powerful computer. And then you print that chipset using the next denture process. It's just coming down the line. See, it took you a while to design it. You're getting rid of it. You're going to put it in that process when it's there, print it. Then what do? You use that more powerful chipset to update your computer design computer and repeat step one. Okay? And just start thinking about this. If ever more engineers and design tool builders began doing this on an expanding number of increasingly powerful computers, the iterative expansion process could explosively generate ever more powerful digital systems. You see, it isn't just the ideas that count. It's how many heads are the ideas rattling around in that are using the knowledge of how to make and build things, to make and build them, and do it in an iterative expansion process. Something kind of cool going on here. That process could exponentiate. But there's a big problem. Where are all these engineers and programmers going to come from, and how are they going to learn to do this? So to cope with that, I began documenting the new system of knowledge in an evolving computer-edited book. Here's some pictures of it, using the Alto computers not only to mechanize the generation of chip designs, but also the evolution of the design knowledge itself, the design knowledge book. So that computer-edited, rapidly evolving book, printed using laser printers at Park, became the draft of the later iconic textbook. Then, following the script used by Steinmetz to propagate his AC methods at Union College in 1910, I introduced the new methods in a special BSI design course at MIT in 78. Picture of the students in the class. And they learned to design chips in the first half of the course, 7 weeks or so. And then the second half, another 7 weeks, they designed project chips, collaboratively, competitively, anything they wanted. And then at the end of the course, I had worked with Pat Castro, who had a laboratory at HP that could do state-of-the-art NMOS fabrication, and we printed the project chips there. Here's some pictures from the students doing design, and what was amazing is that one of the students, Guy Steele, designed a complete Lisp microprocessor as the first chip he ever designed. And here's a picture of the multiple project chips fabricated, just run a one boatload of wafers, got enough to give everybody chips to test, and right down in this corner, left corner down there, you can see Guy Steele's Lisp microprocessor. Now, what's interesting is the MIT 7A course stunned various top folks across Silicon Valley. You see, from out in Silicon Valley, MIT had just run a course that did this. And you know, of course, no one knew who I was, so it didn't necessarily have any connection with me, but MIT had run this course. So people were wondering, how could you do this? And at the same time, many other top research universities wanted to offer an MIT-like course. But how would you do that? After some intensive pondering, I grasped the answer. What if we could just rerun the MIT course at a dozen research universities, using the lecture notes I'd created to run the MIT course? Okay? Keep everything in sync. But then how would you print all the student projects? So I had another idea, which was the concept of an e-commerce system that would enable the design files for the students to be remotely submitted over the ARPANET to a server at PARC. And imagine this, it would run the software to gather and pack designs into the multi-project chip files, like composing the print files for a magazine using remotely submitted articles. You can see the analogy between the two. And then we just print those MPCs again over at HP and quickly return to the students. So this whole thing about instead of asking permission, just be prepared to beg forgiveness. Okay, so you know, they didn't ask anybody permission, basically, but I announced and then orchestrated from Park a huge internet happening in the fall of 79. It resulted in 129 budding student designers to take these Mead Conway courses at 12 research universities. And the way it did it just announced, if you run these courses, we'll print your projects. You see? That's the way it was done. I mean, it was. So here was the last diagram, the last stop e-commerce system that we've created. And here's the flow, basically, of artifacts going from design files down through to wafers, dice chips, and actual package chips. And then the flow of information and activity between all the different groups involved in that. And one of the things that was printed on the wafers, there'd be one chip right in the middle that had that printed on it. Again, just to sort of make the point, no magic here. What we specify in designs got printed. So now let's just step back and envision the exponentiating wave of VLSI innovation. Whoop, wrong. 1976, how to cope with VLSI complexity. 77, coming up with these scalable rules which pull together a lot of the bodies of knowledge and triggered the production of the book. Launching the methods at MIT to where they produced working prototypes. And then launching the courses via MPC 79 to spread those out into a number of research universities. Now here's the key. I'd like you to try to visualize the technosocial dynamics that triggered exponentiation in the evolution and diffusion of the new design ideas. Okay? Basically, if you look at this, there's a design methodology. How does anybody know this is going to work? There's basically the textbook, instructor's guide, and so forth, which codified that, but that was work in process. I mean, you know, you're going to find errors in that. Then there's the courses. So you're going to run a course to, using those materials to teach it. Well, now a instructor has to get up there and, you know, follow this script. And then there are design environments that you need for the students to actually design anything. Then they design projects. Well, now they're on their own. They have to create something, challenge, competition, collaboration. And then there was the method of actually, the e-commerce and all, of actually implementing it. Everything was tested by the design prototypes being produced and checked by the students. So you have a nested cluster of systems jointly being evolved in real time, all in parallel, all right? And you can see that now there's a different pace of things, anticipating kind of what's happened since. There's something else going on now. We're using our tools in new ways socially and doing it in the emerging ARPANET computer research community. So instead of sort of linearly thinking of an idea and then it's out there and it's known, there's a different way of looking at it. It has to do with counting. Where is it? How is it diffusing? Has it been bugs introduced and it's not working anymore? How to orchestrate these things? Well, anyway, to finish that story, by 82, 83, these courses were being offered at 113 universities all around the world. And at Bootstrap, the modern fabless design, where you have designers who don't work for a semiconductor company. They are working on the abstract conceptions, writing the novels, so to speak, to be printed, combined with the Silicon Foundry paradigm of chip making. Now, what's amazing is this went actually way further than Mead had said the limits were. It turned out, fortunately, there were ways to get way beyond that. So over the last 40 years, this thing has stayed on track all the way. Now look at this diagram, which is an exponential because we see the log scale at the left. Starting with several thousand transistors in 71, the number had passed several billion by 2011. And that thing is still going, except there are signs it's nearing saturation. There's links to the whole other story there that's developing. But take a look now. Here's an iPhone 5, the A6 chip, the big processor in there. Here it is. You take the kind of a high school student's microscope and you look at that, you can't see the individual transistors. You cannot resolve them, they're that small. Several billion of them. But such chips are now used by engineers, programmers, makers to mechanize mathematical logic and functionally empower all sorts of things they're embedded inside of. all this stuff, smartphones, wearables, autos, drones, you know, in them are these chips, including the chips that empower the vast internet, logically empower the vast internet infrastructure, which is also expanding exponentially. Numbers count. And so with the internet connecting ever more people and chip-empowered things, just imagine what's going on out there now. Just imagine what's actually going on. Setting the stage for what's coming next. So for more about PARC, there's a great book about it, Mike Hiltzik's book. And for the wider sociological perspective on the emergence of these things I've just talked about, Thomas Streeter has written a really quite fascinating book called The Net Effect. But what's past is prologue. Now it's time to shift from looking backward. Let's look forward. Now, as we turn 180 degrees and look ahead, we glimpse another incoming wave of innovation. It's going to roll by us, and we're going to end up on the other side of it, just like we look back and we can see waves that were there, and we've come through several. It's out there now, just beyond the social time horizon. Now, there's one thing for sure. This one's the big one. I kid you not. This is the big one. Now, why is it starting now? It's further set the stage. Recall that up till now, microsystems are deeply embedded out of sight, out of mind, inside things like all this stuff. You know, people use this stuff, they have no idea there's billions of transistors in these things. That just, you know, mechanizing mathematical logic. So folks just don't visualize the many ideas in motion behind things such as the astonishing out-of-body experiences you can have right now by flying a pair of Bebop using an Oculus Rift. So, you know, I could take my drone and, you know, it put on the Rift, move my head around, and when I move my head around, I'm looking through the fisheye lens in the front of the Bebop, and when I move my head this way, I'm looking over that way. You know, let's say it's just hovering, and then I can look down, and I can look around. Okay. So when this thing is flying and I'm wearing this, really my eyes, and actually in a sense that deep visual sense of consciousness being partly or mostly visual, your eyes are in the pair of Bebop. Now imagine you fly around and you come back and you look at yourself. You look at yourself flying the Bebop. You know, you come in going close and you, well, what is this thing? And you're controlling it, but you feel like you're in the pair of Bebop, and that's, who is that over there? See, there's a whole set of very interesting things that are going to happen as the possibilities of this get explored. And the reason it's going to change is because of a lot of efforts, including Motorola's Project Era, to create things like modular smartphones, which would popularize the concept of hardware apps, not just a software app, but a hardware app. You see, now the many tiny modular versions of big things like cameras, GPS units, inertial measurement systems. Now those will suddenly be little tiny things that you could modularly stick to configure your own customizable smartphone depending on what you want to do. You know, if you mainly want to walk around and use night vision, you might have a lot of different stuff in there so you can see in the dark, you won't need lights compared to someone else going to use it for something else. But especially the tiny micro-mechanisms, the MEMS chips that are designed on computers and printed in foundries, because so much now of what is making these dramatically exciting aren't just the digital computing chips that mechanize mathematical logic, but all kinds of tiny printed micro-mechanisms that enable you to make transducers and sensors of vast numbers of kinds and embed them in this same box or other boxes. So let's just, to glimpse where this is headed, just check out the Xanodrome. This thing is only about this big. I'm using drones because I think people seeing them and you kind of recognize it. These are really real things, they actually work. Now this thing is tiny, about this big, but it includes not just an HD cam, an inertial measurement unit, GPS, the microcontrol unit, but guess what, it has IR, infrared obstacle avoidance. You can fly it around and it won't bump into anything. Won't even bump into another one like it. And that's pretty cool. Gesture control, so you can formulate various ways of telling it what to do by gesturing. Auto-following as you have it, fly around and stay behind you as you're walking around. So that, for example, if you had not an Oculus Rift, but augmented reality where you can see where you're going, but you also have displays of things, like partly a display from the Xano, you could be walking along and you could watch yourself walking along. And if you were in a maze, you could figure out how to get out of it, you see? Metaphorically, you can see extensions of that in various ways. And swarming, these things, now you can make them swarm. If you have IR obstacle avoidance, you can swarm them. So now you see you have so many dimensions of functionality, it's hard to say where the system begins and where it ends. Especially when you add multiple of these on multiple people. And just think of the things you might want to do. There's a great video that you might want to play that link, a video about that. So the point I'm making is these aren't frivolous playthings. They metaphorically illuminate a vast frontier for human empowerment and amplification. If you just don't think of them as complicated, and you think of what are all the really crazy, wild, weird things that would be fun to do, and that would be useful to do, and who's going to figure that all out? Well, anyway, one thing even now that you could think of, what if you got confined to a lengthy hospital stay? Okay, consider a patient, it's in the hospital. She could now actively explore the world beyond her window using her smartphone, control a drone, and see what's out there. See, now what we're going to have to do is we're going to have it so that the nurses and paramedics that work in hospitals, for a certain kind of level of patient, they're going to have to be able to caretake and take drones out so that people can have their eyes go out and wander around even though they're stuck in bed. And now imagine joining your friends on group drone tours of remote places around the world. You know, you could all rent a drone somewhere and get together and fly around and talk to each other over the internet while you're all looking around at something and maybe having it explained by one of your friends. Now, this is all actual, just whatever is going to happen here, this is not complicated. It's not rocket science. It's straightforward stuff. It's more a question, what are we going to do with all these possibilities? So then think. Imagine the impact on today's children when they start looking inside of their nano drones. Now, what is this stuff? This thing is only this big. But they're beginning to notice. I mean, they will realize that this little tiny dot over here is a camera, and this thing's a microphone, and that is a this, and that's a that. And, you know, I can remember when I was little, back in World War II, listening to BBC on a big Zenith console radio. And, you know, one of the things I think they got me figuring things out or wondering what's going on is getting up and looking in the back of this thing and seeing the glowing tubes. And how is this thing enabling me to hear people over in Britain talk? You see? Well, you know, from a child's point of view, this is going to be all quite stimulating. So imagine the wild things. They might figure out what to do next. So what's happening here? Instead of just printing a billion transistors on a single large smartphone chip, we could print a million onto 1,000 very tiny but powerful chips. You can do a lot with a million. You could embed lots and lots of stuff, including MEMS micro mechanisms, in almost everything, putting them where they get local physical data, and enable embedded clusters of tiny chips to logically animate and interactively control lots of macro things. And so there's a tremendous amount of ongoing work even now in various ways of embedding chips in clothing and also embedding these things in metamaterials that provide all sorts of new functional capabilities for interconnection. So this embedded microsystems revolution getting a bit heavy steam now, Silicon Valley, Cambridges, and all around the world. So this is off and running. Now, we can zoom in and look at specific details in microtechnology areas, such as we could take one thing, just little micro camera image sensors, and there's companies all over the place in various spots in this world in terms of the volume of shipments, volume of their shipments versus the costs. And you can see there's different application spaces, but all of that is being probed as various applications develop. So that's one cluster of technology area, and you see a lot of activity there. But here's the key. We can also zoom out and follow the paths of emerging clusters using Gartner hype cycle infographs, where what actually every dot on there is something like that other graph. There's a huge amount of entrepreneurial and innovative activity going on in all of these sectors, but they're all moving at different rates. Some are flashes in the pan. There's hype generated, they develop, and then poof, they get overtaken by other things. And there's a kind of a logic, if you will, an investment community logic in how to track and follow these clusters of technology that we'll see in graphs like this. So again, this is starting to give you a sense of how would you socially map, from an investment point of view, financially map, what the heck is going on here. And just one cluster would be 3D printing. And I want to point out one particular thing about that. MakerBot, a lot of others are producing really great 3D printers now. You can do things like print 3D prosthetic hands that are customized. And once perfected, design files for those could be shared and marketed to users of 3D printers everywhere. So now, just like getting a book on Kindle, you could take a design for an object and ship it to someone somewhere else that has a 3D printer that can make such objects. But now, instead of just looking at it on a screen, you print the object out. And of course, now you see the possibilities for trading, swapping, building, aggregation, exponentiation as these things are shared around the world. Even better, what about making 3D printers that print 3D printers? See, a UK engineer, this guy is amazing, Adrian Bowyer, I'm not sure how to pronounce it, but this guy behind the Global RepRap project, which is actually totally underway, and for more about it, there's this amazing video, a machine that builds itself, and really that's the idea. What we have here is, you know, just as some of the iron was recursively fed back to make more steam engines, to make more iron to further empower the Industrial Revolution, providing such systemic positive feedback here provides gain in the emergent 3D printing technology generation ecosystem. You see? What we have is we have a technology generation ecosystem that is launched by this notion of, this is, again, it's like, okay, I'm going to use a computer to design a better computer so I can design better computers. Well, you can do the same thing here, you see? You can print 3D printers, but you could always modify the design and you could print a little bit cleverer 3D printer. And not just one, you see, you can print more, and that starts to exponentiate. Now back to that question again. Where are all the young innovators going to come from, and how do they learn to surf this wave? Well, guess what? There is a huge wave running through STEM education now of basically technology-empowered, socially exploratory methods for doing better in education. Many incoming students have had experience in Lego camps, fab labs, maker fairs, robot competitions. They can also gain knowledge just in time as needed from many online sources, and some of these are pretty good. I mean, I go back all the time and relearn and actually, maybe for the first time, really understand a lot of things in physics, mathematics, chemistry, and so forth, and do it just quickly when I need it by going to one of these places. Amazing. Now, some of the innovators are going to actually work on doing things down in the micro world, using multiphysics design tools, a lot of new forms of EDA, to innovate microsystems. And here's kind of a slice through increasingly enlarged views of, in this case, a MEMS gyro chip, tuning fork, so you use it to detect rotation. While mechatronics engineers would use team-based augmented reality systems, such as the Dassault's 3D experience platform, Canon's Imreal system, to imaginatively embed that smart modular hardware into and thus animate new waves of human scale systems. So you can sort of see where that's going on. And worldwide, there are examples, especially automotive technology, will be huge drivers of this. Because we are now seeing opportunities for all sorts of new ways of thinking about embedding stuff into a macro structure, which itself is being architected in all sorts of wonderful new ways, including ways that you can 3D print them. So starting with autos, then into mobility technology, and into all of the smart and intelligent roadways that surround all that. And so this innovative embedding of ever tinier hardware is going to quickly spread, and we already hear all these buzzwords, and I think those are glimmers of what's coming. There are senses of something's coming. But I think you can see the texture of what's behind this sort of array of hopes and expectations. Now, how are we going to cope with the complexity of this emerging ecosystem? All this stuff going on. How are we going to cope with the complexity? Or is it really complex? Well, right now, there are all sorts of fabulous new technosocial methods. And we've heard the terms, and these apply in this way. Collaborative learning, crowdsourcing, crowdfunding, all of this, you see, enables more and more people, from engaged users to innovators to makers, to actually scale up their levels of participation in these processes and the impacts of their participation. Only now, and here's kind of I want to make a pivot point here. This starts to get a little bit into political economy or philosophy or something. Instead of just exploring how to make ever bigger things and things that go ever further, ever faster, such as when reaching for the clouds, like building buildings that stick up like that, or even into outer space, what if we increasingly invert our spherical perspective by 180 degrees and look inward instead of looking outward to bigger and grander, look inward? And look deeper and deeper into the inner spaces of the microbio nano pico worlds. And as we explore how to make and share and exploit vast and explore how to make, share, and exploit vast exponentiations of ever tighter, ever more humanly empowering microbio-nano things. So the point would be something like, can't we really start doing more and more with less and less? You know, it's a different aspect of sustainability. Couldn't we actually dramatically, if we just counted things correctly, see progress along a different line? Where we're more and more empowered with less and less stuff, because it's ever smaller, it's ever smarter. And as we zoom ever further into those levels, a lot of stuff we can use to look. Think about the modern equivalents of the great telescopes of yesteryear. We're looking inward. You see, discoveries there will enable adventurers to better gear up for human scale exploration in places and frontiers such as, and let's take, here we have a place where there's some micro world, nano world explorations affecting and infecting with ideas all sorts of things that we hear about, places we hear about, which build on that. And as you just look at the words, I think we all here know many of these. And I particularly point out STEM plus arts equals STEAM. A real deep connection in many of this between art, architecture, design, and art in general in this whole area of exploration. Like, what do we really want to do? What does it mean to be human? How do we expand our humanity? And there's more. And so I sort of pose these as, there's all these things now that are research areas, exploration areas, and that are active. So it begins all around the world. And I think before long, adventurers everywhere are going to be surfing somewhere on this wave. This is going to be catching. If people begin to grasp some of the possibilities, I think we'll have very cool exponentiations where people will come back and show us what they've been able to figure out what to do with this stuff. Now, to envision the masses of ideas now in motion, recall how we diagrammed the rapid nested evolution process for the VLSI revolution. And you can see a lot of it is going from ideas to working prototypes, to a set of processes that involve codifying and teaching, learning and practice, collaboration and competition among young people to jump in and try something new, and then look at the works they produce, you see? And the works they produce sort of frame and validate the whole process. So this really, why don't we have more of our undergraduates actually directly coupled with our research and learning to participate in these things, you know? Time is short, you know, things are changing so fast. Do you want to wait so many years before you even start doing anything? So that's a whole, I don't want to get off on that. But now, vastly more such processes are running in parallel and cross-fertilizing, all intermediated by our new social media and exploratory communications. And a new science named by Alex Pentland, Sandy Pentland at MIT, it's the science of how good ideas spread, the lessons from this new science called social physics. And a lot is being learned right now, especially with the emergence of really hyperscale data science, where you can actually measure and monitor all sorts of diffusion phenomena of mimetics throughout social groups. You can actually start to understand how these flows actually work. Now, it's much more than a simple exponential or logistics process. I mean, that's just kind of an old-timey way of looking at it. The kind of 2D slices through tons of what's going on. So what I want to do is come back and look at the THC profiles and see these as sort of 2D. I put a plus because it depends how you think about the dimensionality of all this stuff moving along the line. And let's look at these things coming. Here's a wave starting. There's one kind of back a little few years. And it's gotten bigger and there's more stuff and the stuff is changing. But just try to get it, you can almost visualize kind of what's going on as this thing starts building up, you see? And there's a really great, well, actually, I guess the other thing about this is, first, is this thing a traveling wave or is it a standing wave? And does that depend on whether you're surfing it or having it roll over you? Or what is this? Okay. There's a really stunning video that just hints at ways to even think about that. I highly recommend this video. It's called Water by Morgan Mawson. And if you watch it, I think you'll love it. Now, there's a challenge. Escalating technosocial change is going to greatly challenge existing cultural patterns because of massive accumulation of past habits, and I think we can sense this. If we're all living fully within the rituals that we have grown up into and cherish, how do we have time to learn all this new stuff? I mean, if I'm going to learn to do this stuff, how do I just get myself to be a beginner again and play with this when that's going to take a lot of time and I just keep doing this stuff? Great book about this, How Do We Drop Old Habits? How to even think about habits? How to notice that you have them? Then two, and this is really important, how can we ever adjust and keep up? Hasn't the train already left the station for many folks? Well, some words to ponder, and there's no judgment value on this. This is just kind of a, call it a philosophical stance by Eric Hoffer that I kind of think this kind of makes sense. In a world of change, you see, the learners are going to inherit the earth. Well, the learned will find themselves perfectly suited for one that no longer exists. And I think, you know, boy, if you think about that for a while, you just think about it. It just, and so that's a problem. It's a problem. But in compensation, you see, we're all learners, but you know, eventually, you're going to get to the point where this is just too much. I'm going to rest and let it go by. But what about this? You see, as the rate of technosocial change increases, we're all going to live far further into the unfolding social future than we ever dared dream. See, people have always wanted to live forever, like all the time. Well, now it's going to almost feel like that's happening. It is almost going to feel like that's happening. And now you get to decide, is this really a good idea? You know, how far do you want to go into a social future? There are a lot of really interesting kind of things going on here. Also, a word of caution, and this may seem to go counter to what I've been saying, but this is actually like a super important point. Do avoid becoming distracted by all the rapidly emerging things. And Kentaro Toyama says this really well in his new book, Deep Heresy. Technology alone won't change the world. We must instead rescue social change from the cult of technology. And I think therein is a feeling that, you see, we can make these things. This stuff easy to do. Believe me, this is easy to do. But it's such a wild and tumultuous space that we tend to see fads sweep through, and the next thing you know, everybody was walking around with cell phones. Before long, they'll all be walking around with Oculus Rifts on. And it's almost comical in a way, because no one has thought about, well, what the heck are we doing? Where are we going with this? Now, another dimension is, you can kind of go counter to that or address that by thinking about the evolution of social leadership. And there's a great little book, the Social Leadership Handbook, that Julian Stott has created, that just in a very elegant and cool way raises some of the questions of how do we find and develop and encourage social leadership and teaming and so forth. Again, this isn't about things. It's about the escalating generation of fusion of ever better ideas on how to make and use things. So now step back further, and what you can see is this is going to trigger huge realignments in political economy and the role of the city in history. And one way to wade into that a little bit, I'd really encourage you to think about the emergence of cooperative capitalism as discussed by Robin Chase of Zipcar fame in her new book, Peers, Inc. Highly recommend that. So in conclusion, conjecture about possible futures. I conjecture that by cooperatively generating and sharing ideas for doing ever more with ever less, this incoming wave of innovation has the potential of sustainably providing ever-increasing infrastructural functionality and life amplification per person, while consuming ever-decreasing energy and material resources per person. These are measurables. Gross domestic products ought to be numbers that relate somehow to these things instead of how much stuff are we making. And thus begin the reining in of our unsustainable overuse of planet Earth, while simultaneously opening an unprecedented exploration of the greatest of frontiers, the frontier of what is it possible to do. And finally, just a personal perspective on our travels through time. If you want to change the future, start living as if you're already there. So thank you, folks. That's
well, Lynn, that was an absolutely fascinating talk. Imagine the richness of material that you have access to in these slides, which will be available. And remember, they contain quotations from Shakespeare and Churchill as well. So we have 10 minutes or so for questions before the reception. Now, there are microphones. So if you want to ask a question, please raise your hand and I'll direct a microphone to you. Please say who you are, and you know how your popularity will be inversely proportional to the length of your question or comment. Let's go, please.
The super talk. One thing that I'm, in a way, I'm surprised you didn't come to, I'm sure you thought about, and that is, and that relates to this iterative process, is artificial intelligence. So taking this a step further, not just computers will allow us to be more powerful in the way we apply our ideas, but machines that start having their own ideas. I mean, are we not on the way to that eventually, sometime, who knows when?
Well, there's a challenge here in establishing the meaning of our words. And the challenge is one of, I don't know, I guess, I think of Van Quine and analytic philosophy, and how do we precisely define what we mean? We often use code words like artificial intelligence, just as on the hype cycles, these little clusters get names as they move and people are sort of working on some stuff and they haven't figured out what it is, but they're all calling it something, trying to make it become something. Now, in this case, there's a couple parts of this. What we've long found in the area of AI is that it's called AI when it's in the speculative domain, but when we actually get it very useful and functional, it then seems non-mysterious and it doesn't have that affect. And so there is a challenge in talking about it. But a couple of things. It does seem likely that we're increasingly going to have steadily empowered, in a sense, personal assistants of a sort that can really help us keep track of stuff and do stuff. And there's a lot of learning going on, a lot of work in machine learning, especially in large social environments, to make all of that just ever better all the time. And so it isn't as though you have an isolated artificial intelligence that will appear, that will sort of take over. It's more a diffusion of things that if you take all the things we take for granted now, to people 400 or 500 years ago, I don't know what words it would just be frightening, you see, and so I think useful things are coming and they're coming very rapidly, which are going to be tremendously empowering, and help people do a lot of stuff. But there's another twist on this, and that is that one wouldn't want to make the mistake that people who are working on artificial intelligence are working on artificial consciousness. You see, we don't. You know, we haven't got a good model of consciousness. Now, at some point, some people will begin talking about you've now got a journal of, you know, artificial consciousness machinery, but back now, you have the possibility of making rather animated, simple, almost insect-like robotic structures that have the capability of self-generating exploratory gates as they respond to sort of the goal of simply moving from here to there, learning how to do all sorts of lower-level things. And so, again, all of this is an evolutionary process rather than like specific things that will suddenly be done. And that's what's exciting about it.
The language changes, doesn't it? Because, I mean, machine learning is creating things which really do look as if they're intelligent.
Absolutely.
At the moment. So there was another question. There's one here. Yes, please. Was there a hand up there? Yes, please. Sorry, I can't see. Where did you want to ask a question? Microphone. Just, it's on. It's
hi, Rod Dulles.
Hold it to your mouth, please.
Hi.
Hold.
How do you reconcile this grand vision with the growth of religious fundamentalism, which is not just Islamist but also Midwest Christians? It is as if inequality these days is not just economic but intellectual.
Keep this one brief.
Yeah. Well, again.
Can I repeat? I mean, that was. Could you repeat the question, because we didn't hear all of it?
The question really is, how do I compare what may to some seem like a kind of, not utopian, but interesting industrial, technological, social possibilities with other aspects of our current situation? And I would just point out that those phenomena are very clearly the same thing. There's a diffusion of mimetic structures in social communities. And so I actually think one of the interesting aspects of this is, as we learn more about that, there are probably some instabilities that will appear as more people grasp kind of what's going on, and others will resist seeing a world in a new, more social way. I mean, I can see some things here that it would be reminiscent of issues around evolution. It's a question of recognizing the reality of our own non-singularity, just being carriers of mimetic structures. And a lot of what we do in life is we're merely propagating memes that have come onto us, and we've learned the moves, and other people see them, and sort of like flocking birds, you know, when a lot of stuff happens, well, I guess there's food there, and they all go there. And so there's all this stuff going on that will kind of shake away at us a little bit about, you know, are we really individuals even? What are we? You see, there's a bunch of stuff that's cutting loose here that I think is going to, well, it'll probably cause more problems for the thinking of people with fundamentalist religious mimetic structures. Maybe that's a way of answering it. I don't know.
Any other questions? Yes, please, gentlemen, and then lady at the front.
What is pushing forward progress in this area fastest? Is it pure science or market-driven science?
Oh, that's a very good question. You know, I think we are obsessed with economic models that reify money, let's say, in a way that avoids seeing it as scent trails, as sort of markers of something's happening, let's maybe go there. And there are other possible drives. You know, I sense in an awful lot of this a very deep driver being an urge to explore, an urge to push out boundaries, an urge to experience, and an opportunity space that's appearing right in front of us where, you know, if you're working, if you could pay your way, but you have a little extra time left over, oh, you can get into things and you can go on adventures undreamed of even a decade ago. And it's going to increasingly be that way. And so what I'm seeing is actually, as more people push out boundaries, are creatively, imaginatively, kinesthetically, intellectually pushing boundaries, finding stuff, sharing experiences with others, what's happening is, over the across the whole world, some wonderful things pop up above all of that. And as people spot those and start to share them, we're really seeing, it's like a new renaissance. It's like a new opportunity for a whole surge of creative things to be done. Anyway, I can go. Yeah. I go on.
Well, I mean, from my perspective, from what I heard from the lecture, it's not a question of either or, which is the most important part. They are both intrinsic to this positive feedback mechanism, which is creating the wave that we are in. Have I got the?
Yeah.
Was I listening?
Yeah.
Now, there was another question here, please.
It might be a hideous function of age that I have become the learned rather than the learner. But there was a famous Greek historian who said once that the reason the Greeks were as productive as they were intellectually was because they didn't have any grass to cut. And the slightly scary thing I keep feeling about all of this is I look around me and I observe an awful lot of people not thinking about very much, but doing trivial things. Mm-hmm. And I almost kind of see this as a progression away from the Greeks.
And we're not talking about people who are tweeting about this lecture, by the way, are we?
No, no, I think I understand. Let me see if I understand the question. And that is that a lot of people, it's almost like you've arrived in a very backward country and you're distributing some toys and everybody is all excited and then you just obsess with those. We're seeing the wave of social media, for example, affect a lot of people, and they're caught up in trying to use it and figuring it out and and centering themselves on just living in that little world for a while, and obsessions almost that people get with the things. And that's just part of the transient process of people being early adopters, getting excited over stuff. Young people especially take a lot of interest in being able to do things that mystify their parents and older people. And so we're having that. We're having a kind of weird generational thing where, in fact, if you want to learn how to use a lot of stuff, the best thing you can do is just ask some kid how to do this. So there's another thing here, is that observing some things being done may look trivial, but you may not be aware of what the mental experience the people are having that are doing it. You may not be aware of the vibrant, new, weird social group oscillatory phenomena are occurring in people that are using even crude social media now, especially kids. They are exploring a space and just learning the early moves in it, so they're going to be ready for the next wave of stuff that comes in. And, you know, this reminds me of, you know, when the telephone first came in, a lot of people never could get over holding it here and talking to it, as opposed to cognitively just suspending disbelief and realizing, well, I'm talking to this person in another place, rather than kind of shouting at it, are they going to hear? And so again, something there has to do with having fun learning new stuff, but also using some sense in what to buy into, because you could waste a lot of time learning stuff that's going to be obsolete next year. That's the other side of it.
That's my problem. Now, I'm afraid I'm going to have to close the question. We have the privilege in the hall that we'll be able to go up afterwards, and I'm sorry to people listening to this outside and later, but we're going to have a chance to talk to you informally at the reception. But I think I would like to call on Professor Tariq Durrani now to give a vote of thanks. Tariq is a Vice President both of the Royal Society of Edinburgh and of the IEEE. Couldn't have anyone more appropriate to give the vote of thanks at this award ceremony.
Well, Lynn, thank you very much. On behalf of the Royal Society of Edinburgh and on behalf of this audience here, I'd like to move a vote of thanks. Your lecture has been most erudite, insightful, engaging, wide-ranging, intellectually stimulating, and challenging. This has been a most memorable Maxwell Medal lecture, crowning a week of celebrations at the RSE of the 150th anniversary of Maxwell's famous equations. As Barry Shoup pointed out, his equations appeared on a paper in the Transactions of the Royal Society in 1865. Madam, your lecture has been quite a tour de force. You have shared with us your deep insight into the technological innovations of the past, and equally importantly, shown us a vision of the future. You started off by talking about looming sunrises and darker horizons. We in Scotland are used to darker horizons. It's a way to see what looming sunrises would lead to. You mentioned the key cluster of innovation ideas. The Royal Society of Edinburgh was established in 1783 because there was a cluster of innovation ideas, and it was called the Scottish Enlightenment. And some of the people that you mentioned over there made significant contributions to us and to the development of this society. You mentioned the propagation of technological ideas, and I'm minded of the fact that a few years ago, in the archives of the Royal Society of Edinburgh, we found a letter that was written by Benjamin Franklin to David Hume, the Scottish philosopher, saying, "I've been experimenting in my back garden flying a kite." We gave copies of those letters of Ben Franklin to the IEEE more recently when we were talking about an MOU between the IEEE and the RSC. Turning to the history that you gave us about the development of VLSI system design, I well remember the excitement your book with Carver Mead on an introduction to VLSI design caused when it appeared in 1979. This became an instant bestseller, leading to a design revolution which changed the face of education of electronic system design, not just in the US but throughout the world. It was central to the development of microelectronics industry and is now powering what's called the Internet of Things. it was very interesting to note from your perspective, and we as mere observers only read it in the books, about the way in which Moore's law was established, the way you talked about the iterative expansion process, the compelling argument you made of teaching design techniques, and then the work you had done in going and delivering this at various universities. I'm minded of the fact that had it happened 30 years later, you would have probably joined the MOOC revolution and ensured that millions of people were able to study and learn about electronic systems design almost in an instance. But I was also interested in the point you were making with regards to the inversion of spherical perspectives, and the diagrams you illustrated and the references you pointed out were indeed very enlightening. STEM plus art equals steam. I'm still trying to work out what steam means, but that's a good thing. You talked about the nested evolutionary process, and more importantly, you gave us a challenge about how we, in our own tiny little minds, can understand what this particular evolution means. You talked about the incoming wave of innovation, and then you mentioned, if I read it correctly, the parrot bebop using an Oculus Rift. I could understand the word using. I could understand the word bebop. I'm not quite sure. And I could understand parrot, but all in totally different contexts. I'm still not quite sure what the parrot bebop using an Oculus Rift implies, but I'm sure nevertheless the illustration you gave us made it quite clear. It was like being able to see ourselves not just as others see us, but as we see ourselves. There's a vast frontier of human empowerment you mentioned, and its amplification, and the development of technologies using drone technologies, using examples of biomedicine. I quite like the idea that you suggested, why not have a 3D printing machine that 3D prints itself. It's an interesting conundrum, but I'm sure we can get to the bottom of it. You talked about the wave of STEM education and the use of new tools and techniques that are coming, and the complexity that it leads to. This is indeed going to be extremely important for us. You then threw some challenges to us from a perspective not just of a technologist, but as a social engineer, and you talked about the massive acceleration of past social habits and how we can change these around. You quoted Eric Hoffer, something awesome is happening. I'm pretty certain, and you proved to us that something often, this particular wave of innovation is coming our way. You then mentioned the importance of social change and moving away from the cult of technology. I'm minded of the fact that we used to call, well, in Britain they're called nerds rather than geeks, and you were just somewhat cautionary in your approach towards being overwhelmed by technology, and I noted from the question something similar happened. Towards the end, you mentioned the ever more and being able to do ever more with ever less, decreasing energy, decreasing materials. I'm minded of the fact that in September, the United Nations agreed on 17 sustainable development goals, and they're all aimed at exactly the same thing, doing more with less, utilizing less material, utilizing it more intelligently. And I would strongly urge people to read the 17 development goals, because they will impact on all our lives, but more importantly, they will impact on the thinking that engineers have and the way in which we should be restructuring our courses so that engineers understand the value of sustainable development. Madam, I'd like to take this opportunity very obviously to thank you for a most memorable and enjoyable lecture, and at the same time to thank a number of organizations and people who are present over here. Both Barry Shoup and David have mentioned the contribution that Cirrus Logic and its predecessor, Wolfson Microelectronics, have made, who have sponsored this IEEE RSE medal. But in particular, I'd like to recognize that David Mill is sitting in the audience. Where is David? There he is. Yeah. David was the individual who ensured that Wolfson Microelectronics supported the establishment of this medal way back in 2006 and continued that support till almost last year. So thank you very much, David. I'd like to thank Barry Shoup, the IEEE president-elect, who came all the way from the US to participate in this ceremony. Thanks, Barry. And I know that Martin Bastians is here. He represents the IEEE Region 8, which covers Europe, Middle East, and Africa, and includes 70,000 IEEE members. He made this very special journey to be here with us to attend this particular lecture. Last but not the least, the RSE staff who have worked long and hard behind the scenes to make it all happen today. Una Carroll, who orchestrated today's event and most of this week's celebrations. The support staff, including our projectionist, Brian, who's hiding somewhere, for all the excellent work he does throughout the year and more importantly for this particular occasion. Madam, on behalf of us in attendance tonight, thank you for your lecture and for the insights that you brought to us. Thank you.